my first true love was working on viruses and figuring out how they work. But then it extrapolated to the disease part of it, so it extended beyond the bench to this virus I work on affects people's lives. And so I applied for funding from the American Cancer Society, and it was in that mechanism that I was able to see people who have suffered from the virus I work on, and it put a face onto the type of work I do. I work on a virus that doesn't specifically cause cancer, but 90% of the general population has the virus I work on. It's a herpes virus, and most people get it when they're infants. And as long as you have a competent immune system, it doesn't cause any problems. The group that it affects severely are people who have cancer within their immune systems, which are bone marrow recipients. And so bone marrow recipients have their immune systems ablated to receive a donor bone marrow system. And during that time, they're without an immune system. And the virus I work on kicks back up and causes problems. And so of bone marrow recipients, 16% will get a reactivation of the virus I work on, and 46% of them will die because of it. What I hope to be able to do is the virus I work on has the ability to go quiet inside healthy people. And when somebody receives a bone marrow transplant, they put them on antiviral drugs for about 100 days. And the reason that they stop at 100 days is the antiviral drugs we have cause liver problems in the people receiving it. So they can only give the antiviral regimen for a certain amount of time before it starts hurting the host. So what we're trying to do is manipulate the factors in the virus to keep it quiet longer in people who just receive an immune system, so that if we can extend the amount of time that the virus remains quiet beyond 100 days, then we hopefully will see people be able to build an immune response and be able to fight off the virus that 90% of the population has. Everybody pays their taxes, and part of your tax money goes to the federal government, and they dole out money to the NIH, and the NIH doles it out to people doing research. So everybody who does the Relay for Lives and sells the daffodils on Daffodil Days and Planted Pink and all the other events, they're already paying for cancer research. But these people now are taking an extra effort to go out there and do that extra mile because they want to do something above and beyond the call of duty. There's this like a image of us scientists being geeks sitting in a laboratory with lab coats on. It's 100% accurate. I mean, it's like the amount of hours we put in, I usually work 10-hour days. I work on the weekends. A lot of times you even forget what the sunlight looks like. I know it's a big yellow one in the sky and you shouldn't stare at it just because we're working all the time. But the fact of the matter is when we get out and talk to these people and you see the response they have and how thankful for the work that you're doing, it's very, very encouraging, and it's a kick in the butt to go back in the lab and do more. But it's completely misdirected, because the way we should be thinking about it is, as a scientist, I couldn't do what I do without their work. And I am totally indebted to them, and I can't thank them enough. I'd like to take this time to thank the people of the East Central Division, because without their footwork and their legwork and all the efforts they do with Relay for Life and all the other events that they put into it and their dedication, there's no way that my research would be possible. And that includes the research of people who work in my laboratory who are going to go on and solve problems in cancer. And so it is completely by the sweat of their brows and the soles of their feet that my research is possible, and it'd be impossible for me to thank them enough.